Hello everyone, I am Sohini Biswas, a third year law student, and currently I am doing an internship at Lexis & Company. Today we'll be discussing on a very important topic, that is burden of proof of the Indian Evidence Act. So let us begin. The concept of burden of proof is defined under section 101 of the Law of Evidence Act. States that when a person is bound to prove the existence of a fact, the burden to prove evidence for the same lies upon him. Chapter 7 of the Act deals with the provisions under burden of proof. The term burden of proof isn't defined in the Act. However, it is rudimentary principle of the criminal that the presumption of the innocence lies with the accused unless proven otherwise. Illustration is, A wants the court to convict B of theft. Since the assertion of theft was made by A, the onus to provide evidence to support such assertion lies upon him. Generally, the prosecution has the burden of proving every element of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt, but while a defendant isn't required to prove innocence in order to avoid conviction, the prosecution does not have to prove guilty of the point of absolute certainty. And despite the general rule that the prosecution bears the burden of proof, there are instances where the burden shifts to the defendant. Now let us understand the principles of burden of proof. The principle of burden of proof is based on the concept of onus probandi, that is burden of proof, and factum probandum, that is proving a fact. While the burden of proof remains constant, the onus for the same shifts from one party to another. The facts that are required to be proved are those which are not self-evident in nature. In the case of Jarnail Singh versus State of Punjab, if the prosecution fails to adduce the satisfactory evidence to discharge the burden, they cannot depend upon evidence adduced by the accused person in support of their defense. Now, what is the shifting sands of burden? When the prosecution establishes a fact that tends to prove an element of crime, the burden essentially switches to the accused, not necessarily to disprove the fact, but to raise a doubt about it. The defendant need not raise a doubt about every fact that the prosecution tries to prove, creating enough doubt about any point that crucial to a guilty verdict will suffice. Of course, the more convincing the fact is, the tougher the defendant's burden is. For instance, suppose the prosecution shows that when searching the defendant, the police found a watch that store reflects up as stolen. In defense of a burglary charge, the defendant would probably have to give a possible explanation for possessing the watch legally by producing a receipt or testimony that the watch was a gift. The defendant would essentially shift the burden back to the prosecution. Now, what is the intent of proving a burden of proof? In virtually every criminal case, the prosecution must prove that the defendant was or had a particular intent. Theft, for example, requires the defendant intend to take an item, not return it. The intent to achieve a certain outcome makes it specific intent crime. With a general intent crime, the prosecution needs to prove only that the defendant committed the act in question, not that they intended any particular outcome from the act. For example, simple assault and battery is a general intent crime requiring that the defendant intend to hit someone or disregard a clear risk of hitting someone. But assault with the intent to rob is a specific intent crime because it requires that the defendant not only intend to strike someone, but also with the intent to rob that person. Now, what are the affirmative defenses that can be taken? An accused may claim that certain circumstances constitute a complete defense to action that would otherwise be criminal. These circumstances are called affirmative defenses. Whether and to what extent the defense must prove an affirmative defense depends on the jurisdiction and the defense. The most well-known affirmative defense is a self-defense. It generally entails the defendant acknowledging that She committed the alleged act, but arguing that it appeared to be necessary in order to defend herself from the harm. An example, fighting of a stranger. Other affirmative defenses include duress, entrapment, insanity, and necessity. Again, whether the defendant carries the burden and what that burden entails depend on the defense and the jurisdiction. For instance, the defendant may have responsibility of proving insanity by clear and convincing evidence. Clear and convincing evidence is a burden lying somewhere between preponderance of the evidence and beyond a reasonable doubt, requiring that the fact to be proved be highly probable or reasonably certain. Now, what can we conclude about this? The burden of proof refers to the duty of a party making a claim to prove that the claim is true. The phrase is mostly common used in the context of criminal trials, where the defendant is presumed innocent until proven guilty. In a criminal trial, the obligation to prove the defendant's guilt belongs to the government. In civil trial, it is the plaintiff, the party making a claim for civil damages, who carries the burden of proof. Because the burden of proof belongs to the party making the claim, the party against whom the claim is made is under no obligation to prove their innocence or to prove that their position is in the correct one. It is important to remember that burden of proof doesn't only refer to the amount of evidence presented, rather the quality of evidence produced is as important as the amount of evidence prescribed. Thank you.